Hello everyone. Today's lesson is about botulism. Botulism is a rare but it's a life-threatening problem caused by a toxin of Clostridium botulinum. To start from the introduction part, there are three naturally occurring forms of human botulism. This is characterized by or this is classified by mode of acquisition. Those are infant botulism, foodborne botulism, and wound botulism. Two other forms. Both human made also occurs and they are classified into inhalational botulism and iatrogenic botulism. Inhalational botulism is from inhaling accidentally aerosolized toxin, whereas iatrogenic botulism is from overdosage of botulinum toxin used for therapeutic or cosmetic purpose. When we came to the etiology, botulism is an acute flaccid paralysis caused by the neurotoxin produced by Clostridium botulinum. Clostridium botulinum is a gram-positive, spore-forming, obligate anaerobe whose natural habitat is worldwide in soil, dust, and marine sediment. The organism is found in a wide variety of fresh and cooked agricultural products. And the spores of Clostridium botulinum strains endure boiling for several hours. This makes it to survive in a different food preservation, whereas the botulinum toxin is destroyed by heating at 85 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes. So the spores of the Clostridium botulism is resistant to boiling, whereas the toxin is heat labile and it is easily destroyed by heating the toxin. Botulism toxin is it's a protein that enters the circulation and it is transported to the neuromuscular junction, and the toxin is only released by actively replicating or vegetative bacteria and not the spore form. So the spore form of the Clostridium botulism doesn't release the toxin. The toxin is produced only by the replicating or the vegetative bacteria. And this toxin or this neurotoxin causes, it goes to neuromuscular junction and it binds to the neuronal membrane on the presynaptic side of the neural synapse. So this is how it appears on a gram stain. It is a gram positive, spore forming and obligate anaerobe. Botulism toxin is among the most potent poison known to mankind, and the toxin blocks neuromuscular transmission and causes death through airway and respiratory muscle paralysis. At least 7 antigenic toxin types designed by letters from A to G are distinguished serologically by demonstration of the inability of neutralizing antibody against one toxin type to protect against a different type. Toxin types are further differentiated into subtypes by difference in the nucleotide sequence of their toxin genes. As with the genes for tetanus toxin, the gene of botulinum toxin for some toxin types and subtypes resides on a plasmid. And the toxin type serves as a convenient method for epidemiological worker, and the toxins types A, B, E, and E and F are well established cause of human botulism. When we came to infant botulism, the epidemiology of infant botulism has been reported from all inhabitants of the world, and notably, the infant is the only family member who is ill. The most striking epidemiological feature of infant botulism is it is age distribution, with 95% of cases involving infants 3 weeks to 6 months old, with a broad peak from 2 to 4 months old. The male to female ratio of hospitalized cases is approximately equal, and identified risk factors for the infant botulism includes ingestion of honey and slow intestinal transit time, that means less than 1 stool per day, or if there is any functional or other cause of constipation, and also ingestion of untreated whale water is a risk factor for having infant botulism. Also, breastfeeding appears to provide protection against fulminant sudden death from infant botulism. Cases can occur in breastfed infant at the time of introduction of non-human milk for feeding. Foodborne botulism results from ingestion of food in which Clostridium botulinum has multiplied and produced toxin. Although the traditional view of foodborne botulism has been thought of as resulting chiefly from ingestion of home canned foods, recently there is a study that shows restaurant prepared foods, including potatoes and other foods, can also cause foodborne botulism. Uncanned foods responsible for foodborne botulism cases include sweet cream cheeses, yogurt, and also fresh and dried fish And also potato salad can also cause cholesteroidal botulism, especially the foodborne type. Many types of preserved foods have been implicated in foodborne botulism, but common foods implicated with exposure include low acidic or pH greater than 6, home canned foods such as carrots, potatoes, olives, and beans are responsible for foodborne botulism, whereas the woundborne botulism is an exceptionally rare disease with less than 400 cases reported worldwide. When we came to the pathogenesis of botulism, all forms of botulism produce this through a final common pathway. That is, botulism toxin is carried by the bloodstream to the peripheral cholinergic synapse, where it binds reversibly, blocking acetylcholine release and causing impaired neuromuscular and autonomic transmission. And infant botulism is an infectious disease that results from ingesting the spores of botulism toxin, producing strains with subsequent spore germination, multiplication, and production of botulism toxin in the large intestine. This sequence is distinct from foodborne botulism, which is an intoxication that results when preformed botulism toxin contained in improperly preserved or inadequately cooked food is swallowed. Whereas the wound form is results from spore germinating and the colonization of a traumatized tissue by Clostridium botulinum. The pathogenesis of this form of botulism is similar in the respect to that of tetanus. So woundborne botulism is almost the pathogenesis is similar to that of tetanus. Whereas inhalational botulism occurs when aerosolized botulism toxin is inhaled. When we came to the clinical manifestations of the botulism, the full clinical spectrum of infant botulism ranges from mild to fulminant sudden death. Botulism toxin is distributed hematogeneously because a relatively high blood flow and the density of innervations are greatest in the bulbar musculature. All forms of botulism manifests neurologically as a symmetric descending flaccid paralysis, beginning with the cranial nerve musculature and progressing over hours to days. Bulbar palsy might manifest with symptoms as a poor feeding, weak cry, feeble cry, weak sac, drooling, even obstructive apnea. These clinical clues, unfortunately, may not be recognized as a bulbar in origin first, and patients with evolving illness may already have a generalized weakness and hypotonia in addition to bulbar palsies when first examined. The brain itself is spared in infants with botulism, since botulism toxin doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier. So the botulism toxin is unable to cross a blood-brain barrier. A patient with botulism, they are mentally alert and conscious, and they know everything and they understand what is going on. In older children with a foodborne or wound botulism, the onset of a neurological symptoms follows a characteristic pattern of diplopia, ptosis, dry mouth, dysphagia, dysphonia, and dysarthria, with a decreased gag and corneal reflex. Importantly, because the toxin only acts at a motor nerves, paresthesias are not common. They are not seen, and except when the patient is hyperventilated from anxiety, the sensorium remains clear. So sensory conditions are intact, but this fact might be difficult to ascertain because of the slurred speech. Since they have slurred speech, it's difficult to assess the sensorium, but most of the time, or almost all, sensory is clear. Foodborne botulism begins with a gastrointestinal symptoms such as nausea, vomiting, diarrhea in approximately 30% of cases. These symptoms are result from a metabolic byproducts of the growth of Clostridium botulism, or from the presence of other toxic contamination in the food, because GI distress is rarely observed in a wound botulism. Constipation may occur in a foodborne botulism, and once flaccid paralysis becomes evident. Illness usually begins 12 to 36 hours after ingestion of the contaminated food, but it can range from as short as 2 hours to as long as 8 days. And the incubation period in a wound botulism is 4 to 14 days. And fever may be present in wound botulism, but it is absent in foodborne botulism unless a secondary infection. So always, fever is not there in a foodborne botulism, except there is a secondary infection. But in a wound botulism, there is a chance of having a fever. All forms of botulism display a wide spectrum of clinical severity, from the very mild with minimal ptosis, flattened facial expression, minor dysphagia, dysphonia, to the fulminant with rapid onset of extensive paralysis, frank apnea, fixed and dilated pupils. Fatigability with repetitive muscle activity is the clinical hallmark of botulism. Infant botulism differs in apparent initial symptoms of illness only because the infant cannot verbalize them. Clinical progression can be more rapid and more severe in very young infants. The incubation period in infant botulism is estimated to be around 3 to 13 days, and usually the first indication of illness is a decreased frequency or even absence of defecation. So most of the time, constipation is the chief complaint in infant botulism. Because they can't verbalize the initial symptoms, and family understands the condition where the child starts to develop constipation or absence of defecation. And the parents typically notice inability to feed, lethargy, weak cry, and the diminished response, responsive movement. Dysphagia might be evident, and increase in secretion, drooling from the mouth might be noted, and gag, sag, corneal reflex all diminish as the paralysis advances, and oculomotor palsy might be evident, but paradoxically the pupillary right reflex might be unaffected until the child is severely paralyzed, or it might be initially sluggish. Lose of head control is typically a prominent sign, and opisthotonus might be observed. Respiratory rest might occur suddenly from airway occlusion by unswallowed secretion or from obstructive flaccid pharyngeal musculature. Death from botulism results from either airway obstruction or from the paralysis of the respiratory muscles. Occasionally, the diagnosis of infant botulism is suggested by the respiratory arrest that occurs after the infant is curled into position for lumbar puncture or following the administration of aminoglycoside antibiotic administration for suspected sepsis. In mild cases or in the early stage of the illness, the physical signs of infant botulism might be subtle and easily missed, and eliciting cranial nerve pulses and the fatigability of muscular function require careful examination. Ptosis may not be seen unless the head of the child is kept erect. So when we came to the diagnosis of botulism, definitive diagnosis of botulism is made by a specialized laboratory testing that requires hours to days to complete. Therefore, clinical diagnosis is the foundation for early recognition of and response to all forms of botulism. The classic triad of botulism is the acute onset of symmetric flaccid paralysis, that is a descending type, or acute onset of symmetric flaccid descending paralysis, clear sensorium, no fever and no paresthesia, and also mentally alert because the toxin doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier. So even we can say a classic tetrad by including alert mentation. Otherwise, the most common well known is a classic triad that is acute onset of symmetric flaccid descending paralysis, clear sensory level, clear sensation or sensation is not affected at all, and no fever and no paresthesia. Suspected botulism represents a medical and a public health emergency that needs to be intervened. And the diagnosis of botulism is unequivocally established by demonstration of the presence of botulism toxin in a serum or Clostridium botulism toxin or organism in a wound material, enema fluid or feces. Clostridium botulism is not a part of normal residential intestinal flora of humans, and it is present in the setting of acute flaccid paralysis, a diagnostic. Electromyography can sometimes distinguish between causes of acute flaccid paralysis, although results might be variable, including normal, in a patient with a botulism. Infant botulism, nerve conducting velocity and sensory nerve functions are normal in a botulism, unlike that of other causes of acute flaccid paralysis. When we came to a treatment part, human botulism immunoglobulin, given intravenously in a dose of 50 to 100 milligrams per kg, should be given as soon as possible after infant botulism is suspected, so as to immediately end the toxemia that is the cause of the illness and arrest progression of the paralysis. When the diagnosis of infant botulism is suspected, treatment should not be delayed for laboratory confirmation. we should have to go ahead for giving human botulism immunoglobulin. Antibiotic therapy is not a part of treatment of uncomplicated infant or foodborne botulism because the toxin is primarily an intracellular molecule that is released into the intestinal lumen with a vegetative bacterial cell death and the liasis. Even some studies show that antibiotics with a clostridium, which causes killing of the clostridium activity, might increase the amount of free toxin in the large bowel, and actually it might worsen the infant's clinical status. So antibiotic therapy is not recommended at all for infant or foodborne botulism unless otherwise there is a secondary infection. Antibiotic use in infant botulism patient is indicated only for the treatment of secondary infection. Even for secondary infection, aminoglycoside should be avoided since this class of antibiotic can potentiate the action of botulism toxin as an endovascular junction. So antibiotic is not needed at all in a botulism treatment, especially infant and foodborne botulism. If there is a secondary infection, we should have to treat that. And when we treat that, we should not use aminoglycoside, because aminoglycosides, they are thought to be, they potentiate the action of botulism toxin as a neuromuscular junction. So we are going to worsen the problem if we give aminoglycoside. But in contrast to that of infant and the foodborne botulism, woundborne botulism requires aggressive treatment with antibiotics and antitoxin in a manner analogous to that of tetanus, and it might require wound debridement to remove the source of the toxin. So wound botulism is managed as that of tetanus. We should have to give antibiotics, we should have to give antitoxin, we should have to debride the wound to remove the source of the toxin. When we came to the supportive care, management of botulism rests in the three principles. The first one is fatigability with repetitive muscle activity is the clinical hallmark of the disease, and complications are best avoided by anticipating them, and meticulous supportive care is necessary. The first principle applies mainly to feeding and breathing, and correct positioning is imperative to protect the airway and improve respiratory mechanics. The patient should be positioned face up on a rigid bottom crib at the head of the head is tilted at 30 degrees. And the patient's head and the torso should not be elevated by bending the middle of the bed. In such position, the hypotonic thorax would slump into the abdomen and the breathing would be compromised. So the head should be elevated to avoid that. And about half of patients with infant botulism requires endotracheal intubation. This endotracheal intubation is best done prophylactically, and the indication to intubate a child with infant botulism include diminished gag reflex and cough reflex, and also progressive airway obstruction by secretions. So if there is a diminished gag reflex, if there is decreased cough reflex, and also if there is progressive airway obstruction by secretion, we should have to intubate infant with botulism prophylactically. Feeding should be done by nasogastric or nasojejunal tube until sufficient oropharyngeal strength or the coordination enable allow oral feeding by breast or a bottle. And expressed breast milk is the most desirable food for infants, in a part because of the immunological components of the breast milk. Tube feeding is also assists in the restoration of peristalsis, an unspecific but probably essential part of eliminating Clostridium botulinum from the intestinal flora. Because sensation and cognitive function remain fully intact, because the sensation is intact, cognitive function is intact, because the toxin doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier, they remain fully intact. Cognitive functions are fully intact, sensation functions are fully intact, so we should have to provide auditory, tactile, and the visual stimulus. Those things are very important, providing auditory, tactile, and visual stimulus. And maintaining strong central respiratory drive is essential, so sedatives and CNS depressants should be avoided. Full hydration and stool softeners such as lactulose may mitigate the protracted constipation. Since constipation is a part of the paralysis, we should have to make them fully hydrated, and also stool softeners such as lactulose should be given. Patients with a foodborne and infant botulism excrete Clostridium botulism toxin and organisms in their feces often for many weeks, and Care should be taken in handling their excreta with full engagement of the hospital infection control staff. When bladder palsy occurs in severe case, a gentle suprapubic pressure with the patient in the sitting position with the head supported may help attain complete voiding and reduce the risk of having urinary tract infection. When we came to the prognosis, when the regenerating nerve endings have induced formation of a new motor endplate, neuromuscular transmission is restored. So the healing process in botulism consists of sprouting of a new terminal and myelinated motor neurons. And the movement resumes when this new nerve terminals locate non-contracting muscle fibers and re-innervate them by inducing formation of a new motor endplate. This process takes about 4 weeks. And in the absence of complication, particularly those related to hypoxia, the prognosis in infant botulism is for full and complete recovery. And the case fatality ratio in foodborne and wound botulism varies by age, with younger patients having the best prognosis. So the younger the patient, the best the prognosis will be. When we come to the prevention of botulism, foodborne botulism is best prevented by adherence to safe methods of home canning. When we say safe methods of home canning, pressure cooker and acidification, by avoiding suspicious foods and by heating all home canned foods to 85 degrees Celsius for greater than 5 minutes, because at this degree Celsius of heating, botulism toxin is eradicated. And the wound botulism is best prevented by not using illicit drugs if they are using that, and also by treatment of contaminated wounds with sort of cleansing, surgical debridement, and also provision of appropriate antibiotics. Many patients with infant botulism, they are presumed to have inhaled and then swallowed airborne cholesterol spores, but this case cannot be prevented. However, a clearly identified and avoidable source of botulism spores for infants is honey. Honey is unsafe food for infants less than 1 year old. And also corn syrups were once thought to be a possible source of botulism spores, but evidence indicates otherwise. And the breastfeeding appears to slow the onset of infant botulism and to diminish the risk of sudden death in infants in whom the disease develops. So we should not give honey for infants less than 1 year, and we should have to adhere to safe methods of home canning of food and heating all home canned foods to 85 degrees Celsius for greater than 85 minutes. And also wound-borne botulism is prevented by appropriate wound care, cleansing, surgical debridement, and also appropriate antibiotics. Thank you. This is all about botulism. Thank you for subscribing this channel.